we are continuing our look at how Latinos will impact the 2020 election. Last week, we focused on Cuban American voters and how they are leaning toward President Trump. Those voters are crucial to winning the swing state of Florida, which CBS News still rates as a toss-up. A recent Pew poll found 58% of Cuban Americans identify as Republicans, but when you exclude Cuban voters, about two-thirds of the Latino electorate support Democrats. For more on this, I want to bring in Tanzina Vega. She's the host of The Takeaway on WNYC Public Radio in New York. Her A Votar series delves into the issues Latinos are grappling with in the 2020 election. Tanzina, welcome. It's great to have you with us.
Thanks so much for having me.
So as we mentioned earlier, the Latino vote is highly diverse, right? I mean, they certainly do not vote as a monolith. Mexican-American voters make up about 60% of Latino voters overall. That's about 18.3 million people. So how do geographical and generational differences play a role in how Mexican-Americans are approaching the vote?
I think what we're seeing are really interesting demographic shifts, depending on whether people were born in the United States, whether they've been here for generations. It's a very complicated vote, and it's one that depends really on how people see their own narrative, right? Do they identify with the narrative of immigration? Do they identify being Chicano, for example, born here in the United States? And I think what we're seeing is that overall, with the Mexican-American population and those of Mexican descent, still about 70% of that population identify as Democrats. So you are going to see a very strong turnout there for the Democrats. But that's not to say that there aren't Republicans. And we're seeing this across the board in terms of Latino voters. Keeping Cuban Americans aside, generally speaking, about a quarter to a third of Latino voters do vote Republican, GOP, or conservative.
Right. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Puerto Rican voters now, because those on the island cannot participate in federal elections, but those on the mainland could play a major role in this election, particularly after Hurricane Maria led to a further diaspora. And there's so many Puerto Ricans now in Florida, and we know how important Florida is. So how energized are these voters to cast their ballots, especially given that FEMA held up $13 billion in aid to the island until just a few weeks ago, which is something that some political observers say was, you know, a very transparent move on the part of President Trump?
Puerto Ricans, both in the diaspora and on the island, particularly those on the island, have been struggling since Hurricane Maria. There's been an economic crisis. There have been high rates of COVID. Earthquakes, natural disasters. The island can't seem to catch a break, quite frankly. And so you've seen over the past decade, really, an increased migration back to the continental United States. And right now, what we're seeing is pretty much double the population of Puerto Ricans living in the continental U.S. as opposed to living on the island. So there are a little more than 5 million people of Puerto Rican descent here in the United States. And I would suggest that that population is very fired up to vote. They've seen how, you know, if we remember back to the early days of Hurricane Maria, how President Trump, you know, threw paper towels into the audience at a press conference. You know, people have not forgotten about the fact that this president has not really been supportive of the island, despite the $13 million that you just cited. So I think people, again, in the Puerto Rican population does tend to vote Democrat, and we're going to see that play out, I think, in certain states like New York and Florida. Florida is a big surprise. And as you've noted, CBS still considers it up in the air. And that's largely because there could be, if Puerto Ricans in Florida register to vote and come out in numbers, we could see a little bit of a shift towards a Democratic ticket in that state. And I think that's something really to watch.
Right. All right. So what about the youngest generation? Because about 3.6 million Latinos have become of voting age since the 2016 election. We are hearing that younger voters are coming out in massive numbers. You spoke with a group of these young Latino voters. What did they tell you about the issues most important to them? And how fired up is this generation to vote?
One thing that's interesting here is that we have to remember that since 2016, more than 3 million Latinos have reached voting age. And so this is a very important number to keep in mind. And remember the political landscape that we've seen since President Trump has taken office. The president started his campaign disparaging Mexican migrants. We've seen large numbers of Latinos dying from COVID-19, particularly those who are essential workers. We've seen really hard immigration policies, hardline immigration policies at the southern border. We've seen families that have been kept, have been separated at the southern border. And so while the president does regain support among about a quarter of Latinos writ large, younger voters are really looking at him. And we even spoke to a younger voter who is not documented and therefore cannot vote and is still very much engaged in the process of bringing information to people. So this generation has witnessed all of that in the few short years that the president has been in office while they've come of age to vote. Many of these folks will be first-time voters. Many of them are becoming very much engaged and involved in what the racial uprising that we're seeing across the country in response to police violence. And many of these communities also share the experience of being racially profiled and harassed as a result of that. So I think you're going to see a lot of movement, particularly among young people, coming out to the polls or at least trying to inform people to get out to the polls and vote for what is important to them. Because a lot of these folks, you have to remember, some of them may even have parents who are undocumented, who are suffering, who are living in fear. And so they may want to go out and vote on their behalf. So I think we are going to see energized youth vote among Latinos this year.
So many interesting dynamics at play in this election. Another one, of course, is the coronavirus pandemic, which is in many ways at the forefront of this election. The economic fallout from this pandemic has hit Latinas particularly hard. Why is the pandemic having such an outsized impact on Hispanic women, and how is it impacting their vote?
Well, let's talk about the fact that Latinas, even before the COVID-19 pandemic, were the lowest paid women when you compare what we make per hour on the dollar to what white men make. And that's lower than Black women, Native women, Asian women, and white women. Latinas are the lowest paid. So now compound that by the fact that many Latinas work in retail jobs and essential worker jobs, doing things like housekeeping or babysitting or jobs that really require them to be on the front line. You've seen a significant drop off in women across the board who have had to leave their jobs because of the coronavirus, because of the fact that they have to, you know, work from home and care for their children. And Latinas in particular have really had the brunt of that experience. So a lot of them are being forced to leave the workplace, even if they don't want to. They've already dealt with low wages, and now this is just going to be another hurdle for them to deal with. And so I think it's something that's really, we're seeing a shift, gender shift, in fact, in terms of who supports the president among people of color. And I would, and the data is really showing us that it's men of color, particularly Latino men, who may be casting a vote for President Trump more so than women.
It is a fascinating gender difference. I wish we had more time to delve into that as well. But Tanzina Vega, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.